welcoming you all to CPR and to this talk on regulatory capacity for the real estate sector, and we're going to be talking about MahaRERA. We are very, very privileged to have Mr. Gautam Chatterjee with us, who is the Maharashtra RERA. So he's the chairperson of the Maharashtra Regulatory Authority, and he's an IAS officer who has previously been in the housing department in Maharashtra. He's been in the Mumbai Municipal Corporation, and he's, you know, served in many, many important positions in the government of Maharashtra. After his retirement, he served as officer on special duty to the Chief Minister of Maharashtra before taking over as the chairperson of the Maharashtra Real Estate Regulatory Authority. We are also very privileged to have our colleague, Mr. Deepak Sanan, who's also a retired IAS officer. He will moderate the talk. They have worked closely for some time on issues around regulation in the real estate sector and, you know, on the national movement towards having RERAs in all the states. Mr. Deepak Sanan he's currently a senior visiting fellow at the Center for Policy Research. And he also advises at the National Council for Applied Economic Research and the Indian Institute of Human Settlements on a variety of subjects related to his experience and especially on issues related to land. So thank you very much for making it to CPR on this very cold afternoon in December. And we didn't anticipate this, but there's also a very big urban conference going on in Habitat Center, WRI, World Resources Institute, have this conference. So this is the reason why I think a lot of people who are quite interested in this talk have not been able to come, but we have a video recording which will go up on our website, and the talk will also be on Facebook Live. So handing over now to our speakers.
2 minutes.
Moderator.
Thanks, Arkaja. Before I invite Gautam to speak, I thought I should just spend 1 minute on saying that when I agreed to be a moderator here was because I jumped at the idea, I must say, because it is for me a real privilege to be able to sit with Gautam here today. And it's not only because I've known Gautam for very long. Let me, at the beginning, in the interest of all transparency, mention that Gautam is a friend and a batchmate. So I've known him for close to 40 years. So, but it's not only because of that I hold this as a real privilege. It is because Gautam has been, to my mind, the image of someone whom I think should be a role model for young civil servants. He has not only been someone who has been efficient, hardworking, you know, a person with integrity and commitment, but he has that one quality which very few civil servants have, which is being able to speak truth to power. He does not hesitate to say what needs to be said. And even more than that, he has that one quality which raises him into a really rarefied realm, and which is a passion to really do something in every job that he's held, to really work on the idea of how do I improve the lot of the clients whom I have to serve. And it is that mindset which really has always drawn me to Gautam, and which has made him a person whom I've held in so much admiration and respect all these years. Just as before we walked in, Arkaja raised the question, why is Maharashtra responsible for doing so many firsts in India, in a sense, in the governance sphere? I don't know, it's a question I have often asked. As I mentioned to you, I can only think of maybe the financial angle, that it is the most, it was, it started post-independence as the one revenue surplus state for first 10 or 15 years of after India's independence, that for the first two finance commissions, even before the devolution of funds from the center, Maharashtra used to be in surplus. So a state which had its own money, which had the ability to think autonomously, obviously bred a certain culture, and therefore it continues to recognize the value of having people like Gautam, chair or head regulatory systems and be in charge even to this day. So with this introduction, I throw open this session and I request Gautam to give us his presentation, which we are all avidly looking forward to.
I don't think I need the mic, unless of course you feel.
Or recording ke liye.
Or recording ke liye chahiye.
You can just put it on the table, okay. It will pick up.
So even if you leave it.
Thank you very much for those kind words. I don't know how much of them I deserve. It's really a privilege for me to be here talking to this August gathering in CPR. What I'm going to do today is there's a small presentation. Depending on the interest it can generate, I think I will go on. I don't mind if you stop me in between these slides and ask questions. I'll be taking questions along also as I am speaking. And of course, after the presentation also, we can have further time for discussion. So today, I'm going to run you through my experience of how we put into practice and activated a new legislation which was brought in this real estate sector. And as we speak here today, we are maybe in the 10th or 11th quarter after the Act has been rolled out in its entirety. And that experience of how, what initial work we had to do so that the Act gets implemented in its letter and spirit is something that I'm going to share with you. So essentially, if I could take you back also the point that Deepak was mentioning, that Maharashtra had recognized that this sector has a problem, maybe within 3 years of the existence of Maharashtra. In 1963 itself, Maharashtra came up with the Maharashtra Ownership Flats Act, MOFA. And if one goes into the preamble of that act, it talked about these things, that there is information asymmetry, there are sundry abuses, malpractices, and therefore there are a lot of grievances that will come up and they need to be redressed. So the 63 Act, which in fact is now about 50 years old, more than that, was already there. But then somehow the problems which were identified even then in the early 60s of information asymmetry, each one of us at some point of time are all home buyers. We require a home, even if we have the first home, one goes in for the second home maybe. And the experience of each one of us would have been prior to RERA coming in, is that we are always struggling to know the person from whom we are buying as to when do we get our home, and very many questions that are coming there, obviously because the money that we are putting into buying that home is our lifetime savings. It's not a simple buy like a fridge or an air conditioner. So information asymmetry was the problem, so it was grappling with this. Problems that we face, where do we go, how do we get our problems redressed, was the second issue. And going to a civil court or a consumer court means that 3 years to 5 years are gone and thereafter you might get a decision. The transactions were lopsided, especially if you go into those sale agreements that were effected between the buyers and the sellers. They were all heavily loaded in favor of the developers, abuses, malpractices. And you have put in money and you're waiting endlessly for your home and you just do not know when it will get completed. So these were essentially the problems. Next. So whenever you have a problem in a sector and you're bringing in a legislation, obviously you're bringing in the legislation to tackle those problems. So we felt that this Real Estate 2016 Act came in on 1st May 2016, but all the provisions of the Act were activated in 2017 May. Because that initial 1 year period was given to every state to create their rules and regulations. So it's a central act, but then the implementation would happen through rules and subordinate legislation by the respective states, and the implementation would be through creation of real estate regulatory authorities and a two-tier system of an authority and an appellate tribunal. So this is what the act contemplates. So if I take you back to those five problems that I enumerated, and if we feel that this Act of 92 section, small piece of legislation, then we need to understand, rather than going into the text of what is written in those 92 sections, what was the basic objective. What did it want to achieve? And I felt that these are the three key objectives not mentioned in those 92 legislation in the letter of written there. But then it wanted to bring in transparency, and transparency through disclosures. So that first objective comes out from, if you go back when the financial market was brought under regulation, that was the principle that was adopted, that you will actually bring in this transparency through disclosures. So I feel this act also puts importance to that, that there should be disclosure. It's very interesting that this aspect of disclosure and mandatory disclosure about various aspects of that product that you are buying in a project was also talked about in the MOFA Act of 1963. If you compare the MOFA Act and this Real Estate Regulation Act, more or less maybe 90% they are similar. But then what did not happen in the MOFA Act is that if someone violates not disclosing, not putting out information, being non-transparent in his dealings, how do you go your, and where do you go to get your problem redressed? That was not happening there. So here, by the time from 63 to 2016, what another important change that had happened was that we had the IT available with us. So you could have used the digital platform to put out all the information and the disclosure, make it mandatory and ensure that the mandatory disclosures are put out in the public domain through the digital platform. So the first key objective is, how do you achieve transparency? Second is that, though again MOFA talked about, how do you complete a project, but then there was nothing in the text of that act which ensured that the project would get timely completed. Now this act essentially not only brings under its fold prospectively any project that will come in after this act has come into effect, but also brought under its fold all legacies of the past and the burden of the past, which were projects which were hugely delayed and not completed. So this aspect, when it was challenged, when the constitutional validity of the act was challenged in the Mumbai High Court, in the Neelkamal judgment, this was raised there that why are you making it retrospectively applicable? And the decision was that there is no retrospectivity because we are talking about, we want to complete a project which has not got completed. So essentially, we are taking under our fold all such projects which should have been completed, and therefore we define them as ongoing projects, and all such ongoing projects must come under the ambit of the Act. So in order to complete not only an ongoing project, but also any new project that will get launched, the Act talked about two things, very interesting. It said that even if that old ongoing project had an initial timeline of maybe completion in 2014, 15, 16, God knows whenever. Now that you are coming under this Act, please tell me by what time, finally tell me, by what time you should complete it. The rules additionally said that it will not be under your whims and fancies that you say, I will do it by 2030. No, that timeline has to be commensurate with the balance development work that is remaining in that project. So it talked about time, first essential feature that will be required if you want to complete something. Second was, it said there will be a ring-fenced fund. So create a separate dedicated fund, and the monies coming in from the buyers will first get into that fund. It talked about 70% money must get into completion of the project. So these are the two most important features, and therefore I say that this is an act with this objective that the project must get completed. And therefore we say, and that's how, in fact, when people ask me, how is it that you have 23,500 projects registered in Maharashtra only, when there are only 45,000 across the country? I said that because I say there is a difference between giving a license and giving a registration. I'm not giving any license to a person that you come and I ask 20 questions to see how can I say no to you. I'm doing this because I want you to bring it under this fold, because the win-win situation would be for everybody. The project, once it gets registered, it's my baby, and I'll ensure that the project goes towards completion. So completion is the reason why you should register, and we had all the PI guys coming in and registering. Third, another very important aspect, which has been the real problem of this sector, there is absolute trust deficit between the buyer and the seller. I just cannot have faith in the chap whom I am putting my life savings to buy maybe a one-time buy of my whole life, and I don't know that the quality of the product, the timely delivery of the product, and whole lot of questions, and I do not know whether that would happen or not. That is certainly not a good thing if you're talking about such an important sector like real estate, which in fact is the most important employment generator, so important for GDP and stuff like that. So how do you rebuild trust? So if we keep these three objectives in mind and then talk about what are the pillars on which the act is formed, it talks about fiscal discipline, which I mentioned, that money is coming to the project, has to be ring-fenced and ensured that the project money gets into the project itself and you're not diverting the fund, which all of you would have read in so many projects would have happened in the past. It talks about transparency, most important aspect of this act. It talks about accountability and compliance. You are for the first time trying to tell this bunch of stakeholder called the developer that you need to be not only professional in approach, you have to be compliant with all the provisions of the act. And if you don't do that, then there are serious consequences of that. Penal provisions are very heavy. Speedy grievance redressal certainly is one of the aspects that any person has a problem, he raises the problem, it should get aid. And therefore we say that there is a specific citizen centricity in this act. The main aspect of this is that the consumer is at the center of the focus when we talk about doing this. However, while you are implementing it, it is not that you are sitting there as a consumer court to say any problem that individually brings to you, you only resolve the problem, it gets solved. You have to keep in mind, ultimately, these are the objectives that we are trying to achieve while we are implementing this act. Next, please. These are some of the building blocks, I say, of MahaRERA. MahaRERA standing for Maharashtra Real Estate Regulatory Authority. We have decided that if suppose we have to achieve what we could not achieve in the 1963 Act, it can be done only through digital governance. So digital platform would be the platform on which we will implement the Act. And therefore from day one, or rather I should say it was midnight one, 30th of April 2017, at 12 midnight, we actually activated our web portal and there were two developers who were challenging to say, we want to see whether there'll be glitches enough and the portal will not go live. And it actually went live. And he asked me around 10 o'clock in the night that this is software, it can go wrong. And it does go wrong, and it did go wrong, of course. At 12:52, he called me to say, sir, thoda problem ho raha hai. And we said that, yes, we'll resolve that glitch. And we resolved that on the next day morning, he got the first registration of RERA in the country. So we felt that, yes, digital platform should be the way that we should do it. And therefore, today, we are very proud to say that it is a paperless office. And we would try and we would be very happy if it becomes a zero footfall office. It is certainly a zero footfall as far as the promoters are concerned for the purpose of getting registration done, or a real estate agent for getting his real estate agent's registration done. He doesn't have to visit. Everything is done online and he gets a digital certificate on his desk. But then when there are complaints that are filed, for hearings of the complaints, people do have to come. So I'm looking at a day when maybe we have created a situation where the complaints are also getting resolved through the conciliation forum, which I'll talk about. In that case, it will be not only zero paper office, it will be a zero footfall office also. Participative governance, basically we felt a new act, awareness creation among all the stakeholders will be certainly the essence in which we can actually bring in the implementation of the act in the real spirit. And therefore, we had umpteen number of stakeholder meetings with the promoters, with agents, with consumers, whole lot of them at various places, Mumbai, Pune, Nashik, Nagpur, at variety of places. And a lot of questions were asked. Those questions generated were put into what we called as the FAQs, and then also we added them here. Because the questions were answered in a forum which had say 500 to 1000 people, but then whatever we answered, we captured them and put them in the FAQ so that the whole state benefits from them. Minimum government is something we felt that if we have a very robust software which is ensuring that while a person files an application online for getting his registration done, the software itself is so robust that it asks questions and it is allowed to go ahead to file the application because all the mandatory things that are required are ensured that he files and then only the application moves ahead. at every stage he is able to tap, see as to how his application is moving. All those things are available in this. And therefore, today, we have little over 30 people who can manage this whole regulatory mechanism under the real estate sector in MahaRERA. And we feel that people are not stressed. But then you can talk to the guys, whether they share with you and say that, no, boss puts too much of stress on us. But I feel that people are quite happy and things are moving quite well as far as this is concerned. Accountability and transparency in working, we try and do that as far as possible, not only for whatever information that is put out by the developers and put out in the public domain, but also we went ahead and said that in spite of everything being transparent, if there is an RTI query, then obviously the person has some question. So whatever RTI queries we have replied, we have put it out also in the public domain. So every information that we can, we have tried to put out in the public domain. And this is something which I will talk a little detail when I go down, that we have tried to continuously innovate to see whatever is not mentioned maybe in those 92 sections. But then if I again try and extrapolate that our objective is that how do we build trust, how do we have timely completion and more transparency, we thought that these things also are necessary, though they are not mentioned in the Act. How we can resolve problems through conciliation, how through self-regulatory organization concept among developers, try to bring in more professionalism, especially in a totally unorganized type of sector. The way, if you see, though we have the likes of CREDAI and NAREDCO, which are the bodies which claim to be the representative body of the developers, but to my utter surprise, I found that of my 23,000 projects that are registered with me, hardly 4,000 projects are belonging to their members. And the remaining are all standalone guys. So we felt that this is a very dangerous situation. A person suddenly stands up, and because there is no threshold limit for a person to become a developer, he has land, he has some money, he gets some approval, and then he has to come. The law requires him to come and get registered. He launches the project. Whether the various things that need to go into before launching a project has he done or not, the level of professionalism that is now required now that it is under a regulated sector, does he have that? How do we actually ensure that that happens? So from that emanated this concept of SRO. I'm going to talk about that a little later. Quality certification, another thing that we felt that needs to be brought in, though it's not talked about. The Act talks about that after the home is delivered to a buyer, for 5 years there will be a defect liability clause. The defect liability is something which is curative. I enter into the home, after 2 years I find no, something is terribly wrong here. And then I raise a complaint and then you resolve the complaint. So we felt, can we go into the preventive mode for this? Can we ensure right from the beginning that the quality aspect, and quality is a function of what? It is the raw materials, the intermediate products, the skill of the workmen who convert the raw material into the finished product. So both these aspects we took up and we felt that we should have more accountability on the engineer of the project, which is also a part of the Act, and he should certify through a generated form that we actually worked out, Form 2A, which talks about the quality of the various input materials that is being used, and even also the product which is created, maybe the concrete, through a non-destructive test, whether it meets the National Building Code criteria or not. This is something which we have only done in Maharashtra, and we feel that this is certainly going to improve further the comfort level of the buyer. Essentially, all these things are to give that extra level of comfort to the buyer, that I am not only buying into a real estate RERA registered project, I am also buying something from my life savings, which will be a product which is a quality product, and the workers who have worked on my house, on my home, creation of my home, are people who have also undergone a skill program and they have the necessary skill. So these are the areas on which we are further working. Next, please. This is, I thought, let me also document some of the initial struggle that we face, because we find that today we are able to be at a stage where wherever we are among various RERAs is because the initial homework that we did before we went ahead and launched the whole program. So it all started with the one member interim authority. I was appointed, but that was sometime in November, December 2016. The Act came in. Of course, few months had been lost. The then Chief Minister was very keen that it should happen maybe from May, June itself. But then it didn't happen because there were some problems within the bureaucracy. There were people that they are much better placed to do this job than me. So that's how it didn't get, the decision could not get taken. So once it was taken, then we started working. And the one point the then chief minister told us is that try and do it on time and do it from day one, it should be on a digital platform. The act itself says that after 1 year of 1st May 2017, that's from 1st May 2018, everything should be on a digital platform. But here we decided that we should do it right from day one. And therefore, we felt that this will require, one, someone who will do this IT work for us. So we are fortunate to have Maha Online, which is a joint venture company of Maharashtra government and TCS. So they were very, very sound. And we also had knowledge partners as KPMG. So they together, actually the three of us, started working. And whatever I have listed out here is something we did from this December to April. We worked on the rules, we worked on the regulations. And then on 1st May or midnight of 30th April, we had the authority in place. We had the other members also joining in very soon in June. And thereafter, whatever they have been able to do is what I'm going to now explain to you. Next. So as I mentioned, creating awareness we felt was very, very important because an awareness creation across all the stakeholders. So we had huge gatherings. If you could see, some of these meetings were attended by as 1,500, 2,000 people. And we had a very active consumer forum also, the Mumbai Grahak Panchayat. So they felt that we should also have this forum organized for all the buyers. And there were tremendous amount of problems of the home buyers. I mean, all of us are aware about that. Also with the developers, also with this staff of 30 people, because that capacity building was also very, very necessary. Otherwise, we keep on telling the people that, no, we are going to do this. But this small, dedicated team of people whom, of course, I handpicked, people who had worked with me earlier, either in MAHDA or in BMC, and of course, some new guys, youngsters who know IT. So that is how we had a lot of these knowledge sessions. And next, please. So this is where we stand today. Essentially, that first thing that I mentioned there, there was a 3-month window period provided when the act came in on 1st May of 2017, asking all the old projects, the ongoing projects, to be brought in under the ambit of the act. Because the act said that from 1st May onwards, any new project must get registered first and then only will start sale and advertisement. But those projects which were already there, a 3-month window period was provided. And in that 3 month, which ended on 31st July, interestingly, 95% at that time of projects total registered in the country were with MahaRERA, which now, of course, today is, we have 23,000, it's about 400 now, out of about 46,000 in the country. 22,000, this also has gone up to 23,000 out of 35,000 in the country, real estate agents. And complaints also. But then if you see the total number of complaints that we have received, which I said is around 9,500, and 6,500 have been disposed of. 9,500 complaints in 23,000 projects. And 23,000 projects, when completed, will complete 23 lakh homes. So we are talking about 23 lakh homes under construction, of which about 4,500 odd would have got completed, I mean projects. The number of complaints, that way speaking, is not a very huge number. Both things are possible. One, that they don't have problems. Two, further awareness will have to be created. That when you have a problem, don't sit back, come forward and raise the problem. Okay, so this is how we are. This also we felt is another interesting thing, that while we are trying to educate people that henceforth whenever you are wanting to buy a home, how do I empower you so that you can take an informed decision on your own without basing your decision on somebody else's saying that, no, I know this guy is a great developer, why don't you go and put your money here? So here, through this GIS map, we are able to now tell a person that he can go and click on wherever he wants to do that, and then it opens the web page of that project, and it gives all the details. It's actually a game changer. All the details, including last 5 years of the credibility of the developer, any litigation in the project, the land title report of the project, encumbrances in the project, and the project per se, as to how it is moving, is it selling, how many bookings have taken place, and the various aspects of excavation completed or not. And this needs to be updated every quarter. So that is how the information, as I mentioned, transparency, is at that level it can reach to a person. So if I can attract all the people who are looking for their homes to go and hit at least once my website and then go into and seeing this as to what is happening, then I think I have achieved much. Today, number of hits is only 52 lakhs, but I would have been happy if it was 5.2 crores. That's how it should be. The people actually should go into the website, test them out. They are still basing their decision on someone, some agent telling him that no, this is the correct project, why don't you go and put in money? So that is an area and a challenge. Yes, you wanted to ask.
Is there a challenge of overseeing 23,000 plus projects with only 30 members staff?
Yeah.
Or have you managed to automate?
No, it's a question of, we are not micromanaging those 23,000 projects. As I mentioned to you, it is based on the projects are giving mandatory disclosure of information, which they must give. The software itself was robust enough to capture that. While we were registering, we were ensuring whether they have given those information correctly or not. The correctness of the thing we're seeing on whether the legal title report that he has put up is the correct legal title report. He is the landowner. Two is the approval that has been given by the planning authority. It is in his name, his PAN card that is there. So these are the uploads that he does, is checked at the time of giving the registration. All the other details that he is supposed to give, he must give, otherwise he will not be able to file the application. Once he puts out that information, it goes out in the public domain. Then it is for everyone to see. We have then complaints raised. If suppose the data is incomplete, or the data is wrong, or anything that a person has a problem, so it actually goes on that reactive mode. So there, we have 9,500 complaints, which is also not a small number. So that many complaints that have come, there are a few complaints which are of this nature. He has not put out that litigation. He has put out his legal title document, which is not correct. These are also complaints, and they are punishable offenses under the Act. And we have also punished. So, and any order that he put out also is out in the public domain. So essentially, putting out information in the public domain also helps not only the delinquent developers to sudhar jao, but also to people to know that yes, something is correct or not. But I would be happier, as I mentioned, if more people could go into seeing and be by eyes and ears to tell me that this is not correct.
So
we are not in that mode of our chaps going and sitting and finding out what did you put out right or wrong. That's how it is.
So that's how you manage with, like, even though you have small stuff, you have...
Absolutely. Absolutely. Next. So as I mentioned, it's a 100% digital platform. These are the type of services. So GIS-based, as I mentioned, online project registration, online agent registration, online complaint management, online project extensions, online corrections, if he wants to do some correction. All these things, he doesn't need to come to my office. He actually has all those tabs available for him, and he does that. We also had this problem of the project, I can file a complaint only when the project is registered. But I feel that the Act requires that project should have been registered. In spite of the fact that I have 23,500 projects registered with me, of which 13,000 were the old projects which have got registered, still we found that there are some people who did not come forward and register their projects. Very small number. So we had this online non-registered project complaints also tab. So person files a complaint. We started off by saying that this will be not a complaint because you cannot file a complaint unless the project is registered. So we said that it is a source information that you give, and we will examine whether it requires to be registered. And if it requires to be registered, we'll get it registered and also impose penalty. A chap went to the High Court saying that no, it cannot be only an information. I would like to be present to prove my case that no, the case does require registration. So we created that tab later on, and it's working fine. We have sent 600 complaints filed here also to say, please register. And about 50 of them, I hear them, we have ended up in giving the order saying that you must register. So all these things are online. Next. That's the home page of ours. Yep. Yes, please.
What do you mean by online adjudication?
Can we go ahead? So online adjudication is, again, all the initial work that you have to do to file the complaint comes through the online method. But then, actually speaking, it is still the adjudication or the hearing of the complaint. We are doing it by physically the parties coming there. But then in some cases, we tried also the video conferencing mode of the person doesn't have to come down from maybe Pune to Mumbai. We also opened a bench in Pune. So that is another area that we'll have to work on to see whether that also can be, that physical interface can be minimized there. So that's an area where we need to work on. Yeah. If I could just briefly run you through that, I would expect after my talk today, all of you do make one hit of my website. Piche wala ek bar. So it's a very informative one. So the home about us gives all the things. We are now an ISO certified, the only RERA in the country which is ISO certified. We are the only RERA in the country who have published with CAG report two annual reports for your information. The other day I got the first annual report from Punjab. So we have already done for two annual reports already published and put out there. We have also in the downloads put out a compendium of best practices. Certain things that we felt is in fact something that we feel proud that we have done it. So we wanted to share that. That's also put out there. Skilling initiative, another tab, where we are talking about all aspects of whatever we are doing on skilling. Essentially, skilling also we felt that it was our dream. Unfortunately, it has got hit by some roadblock because of this change in government. Our dream was that in 5 years' time, in Maharashtra, you walk into any RERA registered project that's going on, you should be meeting people who are working on that, is our workers who are all skilled. So we then assessed, what is that quantum? It'll be about 12 to 15 lakhs. What is the bottleneck in trying to skill them? Who will skill them? So we said that we need to have first a training of trainers program, training of expert trainers. And the National Skill Development Council has had all these courses available with them. So we said that MahaRERA will spend 5 crores to create a pool of 500 expert trainers who will then go out and then do the training for the remaining 15 lakh. And we have huge amount of money lying in the labor cess. This is collected in every state. In Maharashtra, this money, and they don't know how to spend it. Do you know how much it is? 7,000 crores. So then we worked with the earlier government, and we had this program, that second stage of program will be then conducted through this labor cess money, where the workers will get job loss money and other monies, and therefore the trainings will happen. We had started, some trainings also took place, but now we hope that as soon as the khate vaatap, that means the portfolio distribution takes place, we'll have ministers in place and they will take this forward. This is registration, which gives out all the information about registered projects, registered agents. We have non-registration, we have online application for filing of application, filing of complaints. Then the appellate tribunal information is there. Conciliation forum is something that we created, I'll talk about it a little later. And statistics on a real-time basis, if you go there, you will find how many applications have come in, which are in the stage of processing, how many already approved, how many projects completed. And all the statistics available there. Next. It gives out the daily cause list also of the hearings that take place. That information also puts out in the public domain. So as I was saying, about 23 lakh homes we are talking about, 1.1 crore citizens will benefit out of this. Total investment involved in these projects is about 8 lakh crores in the projects they have completed. This is the amount of money and this is the amount of benefit it will do to the country. We are talking about 23,000 projects, 4,000 projects completed, so many agents. We are talking about 20 lakh professionals, the laborers 15 lakhs, the engineers, the architects, the various other professionals who are also involved there. How do we keep on improving and making them more professional while they are working on these projects? 8% contribution. Next, please. These are some of the things, in fact, that we have, as I mentioned, the ISO certification, that is what we got about 3 months back. This conciliation forum is some idea that came to our mind. In the initial, some of these stakeholder sessions that I was holding, this chairman of the Mumbai Grahak Panchayat, a very active consumer forum, he raised this point that in the act there is a section 32G. Though I had read that, but then I had glossed over because it is a subsection of one section out of the 92 sections, which talks about that effort should be made by the authority to request the state government to have problems resolved through conciliation mechanism where the developers association and the home buyers association will sit to try and see how they can be doing. And he raised this point that why don't we work on this? And thereafter, we took upon this point and said that, yes, this will be a great idea. Why don't we do it? And that's how we started the work of setting up Conciliation Forum. The Conciliation Forum works in this manner. This is also, again, online. If you have a problem, the Act says that you have to raise a complaint. When you go into my website to file the complaint, you get a message saying that, would you like to try the Conciliation Forum? And then the Conciliation Forum, how it works is explained to him. It's like this, that you will raise your complaint in a similar manner as you raise a complaint to the MahaRERA authority. And as soon as you raise that, it then goes on the dashboard of the developer, because everything is online. And the developer knows that there is a complaint which is coming, and he wants to do it through the Conciliation Forum. He gets 7 days time to respond to it. In most of the cases, he doesn't. Again, due to lack of awareness, not that he doesn't want to do it, because that came to our notice that the person who has done the registration for him has now nothing to do with the project. The guys who initially got this idea that he must register his project, he was convinced that his project should be registered, but he had no clue how to go about. And then we had mushrooming of some consultants who knocked off huge amounts of money and generated maybe 50 mobile numbers and then got 50 registrations for him, took his money, and then walked away. And this we understood when we found that these projects are not getting updated. They are supposed to be updated every quarter. When we started sending mails to them continuously, the mails are going, but still he's not responding. We held sessions calling these so-called non-compliant people because we felt it's a new act. I cannot just rush to penalizing him. He has violated the law, but then that is not the way I would like to implement this act. So we held these sessions and we came to know that he has no clue. And thereafter, we had to then train him to bring him. And that's how the concept of SRO also came in. And that's how we further tightened this whole thing of conciliation. So the second party accepts that, yes, he's willing to sit in conciliation. As soon as he says yes, then the first party pays 1/5 of the total fee that he's otherwise supposed to pay for a complaint, a quasi-judicial complaint. And once he files that money, we have these 28 benches in Mumbai, Pune, Nashik. Since it has caught up, we have set up these benches at other places also. A developer representative and a Mumbai Grahak Panchayat or any other Grahak Panchayat's representative. And the two then sit with the person, the first complainant and the developer, and they resolve. And you know, in Pune, 9 out of 10 cases get resolved amicably. In Mumbai, it is 8 out of 10. And that was this paper that was presented in ANCTAR and was also appreciated. So I thought I must refer to that. Next. We also have some awards. We got the last year's National Award for E-Governance from the Government of India, because 100% digital platform, everything on the digital mode. And some other awards I thought I must share with you. Next. Some of these write-ups also. Next. Now, as I mentioned, I have already mentioned about the quality certification. This is one thing that we felt we need to do. We have to further work on that, because as data comes in and we analyze the data further, then we understand that we need to further work on them. So these forms 2A, which are being filled in by the engineers, we are now holding a technical session with them to try and tell them what is it that they need to do, how much more professional they need to be while they are filling up this form 2A every quarter. And they are actually making themselves accountable to say that the work is going on in the perfect manner. So they should know whatever they are signing, are they signing properly or not? Because tomorrow, after 3 years, when a person raises a complaint against the quality of the building, he might be then hauled up for giving wrong certificates. So these are the ways we'll have to further work on quality certification. Skill development, I have already explained to you. GIS mapping, I have explained to you. MahaRERA conciliation, I just now spoke with you. That the only here, the problem that I feel is, where we need to work further, that the proportion of complaints coming to conciliation vis-a-vis coming to us for quasi-judicial disposal is 1:10. So out of every 10, only 1 goes in conciliation, 9 still are coming to us. So we have been trying to analyze. I was telling Deepak that we need to do a research to find out why. Why would people want to pay 5,000 more and also file complaint here? When he can go to conciliation, it doesn't close the option for him if the conciliation fails to come to us. And the experience shows that in majority of the cases, it's a win-win situation for him. So why does he not opt for that? Now, in conciliation, we don't allow advocates. And here, the RERA has been a boon for advocates. So all complaints that are coming in, the advocate then advises. Now, obviously, when you are in trouble, the first place we go to is try and ask the advocate. And advocate advises him, yes, sorry, I hope you're not an advocate. No offense meant, yeah.
So what's the temporalities of different distinct conciliation? How much was the time frame in which it's resolved, as well as the quasi judicial? What's the time frame?
Time frame, in fact, in some of the cases have been on the first meeting itself, in 2 hours it has got resolved. Some difficult cases, it has gone on for 5-6 sittings also, where in fact the conciliators have gone on to say that no, it cannot remain confined to only one individual. We need to bring in the association of allottees too, because we are keeping in mind larger perspective of how one decision of conciliation should not adversely affect the project, and that is how also it has happened. So some of these are real great case studies as to how the conciliator really molded the decision to a manner where even the person who raised the complaint stopped looking at the complaint only from his individual perspective. He started looking at it whether how it's going to adversely affect my other buyers in the project. So it differs from that. We also wanted to get into case studies of those 2 out of 10 which failed. Why did it fail? And thereafter, we have just now introduced that. We have said, again, to further strengthen conciliation, that once in a conciliation, the developer says yes, and then doesn't turn up when the conciliation takes place. It could be a reason that the developer wanted to use it as a time buying mechanism. So we have given the power to the conciliator in such cases to send it directly to us, which we will treat as a suo motu complaint and take it forward as a complaint. We have just issued a circular to that effect. Yes, please.
Just to clarify, who are these conciliators? Like, what's their background?
The conciliators are the likes of Niranjan Hiranandani from the developer side. And from the consumer side, we have this advocate Shirish Deshpande, who is himself the chairman of Mumbai Grahak Panchayat, and very many such elderly people who have been working in the consumer space for a long time. But then they also went through two days of training session. There's a person by the name of Mr. Ajay Mehta, who has been doing this job even for Supreme Court and High Court judges. So we got hold of him, and initially when we wanted to launch conciliation, we had a 2-day workshop attended, and throughout 2 days were attended by all the likes of Hiranandani and people. And just 2 months back, after one year, 15 months of successful implementation of conciliation, we wanted to take a feedback, another 2-day workshop which we held in the National Law University in Mumbai. Again, Mr. Ajay Mehta was there, and from there only emanated these points, as I just now mentioned, that how do we further strengthen conciliation? We can do that if a conciliation fails because the person wanted it to fail, and in the whole process he has killed 6 months. And if the conciliators come to that conclusion that it has happened because of that, he raises the point to us and we take it up as a suo motu complaint. Yes, please.
When someone approaches you with a complaint,
before
accepting the complaint, you advise them about the process of conciliation?
Not at that stage. When he has approached with the complaint, it's all online. So he's filing the complaint, and in fact it's his right that he has decided to go for the complaint. I advise him only through my website. It gives him a pop-up message.
Okay.
Would you not try the conciliation? And then if he says yes, it takes him to that window.
Okay, so this is an option.
Yeah, that's what we do. So that's about conciliation. Yeah. Self-regulatory organization is another thing we felt, that if we have to make this, yes,
and then we have appellate tribunal also, where one can, again appeal regarding anything.
Appeal is against the order passed by the authority or the adjudicating officer.
Okay.
The appellate tribunal is meant for that.
Before.
Conciliation essentially is that it kills litigation, further litigation.
Okay.
That's the win-win situation of a conciliation.
Okay.
Why a developer also would be interested in conciliation? The conciliation decision is confined only to that closed room between the two of them. Any decision that I take, or the adjudicating officer takes, or the appellate tribunal does, is subject to further litigation. And two, all that information is put out in the public domain. And we had cases when one decision taken, suddenly then I had an advocate opening shop next day, where he's asking all the person in the project, there is something like this order is coming out, so why don't you come to me? So, yes, someone raised their hand.
Yeah, so what percentage of signed between the two parties, and both parties actually, you know, adhered with it.
Yeah, that was another point that was discussed in this. After 1 year feedback session, I would say around 80% are adhered to. 20% also would not have been there had we not had the ILFS and the NBFC crisis. Because when the person in the conciliation says that, yes, I'll abide by this, please give me some time, it's essentially the conciliation is that I have lost money in this. I need some money. I need some rent. He would have also said, 3 months he also pays that. And then the situation becomes so bad that the project is just not moving. The people who are there in the project says that I want to get out of the project. The NBCC, the NBFC, which was giving money to the project, sanctioned project, has stopped giving money. So we have that. That's a very serious problem in the sector today. So there have been instances of this. But then, what do we do? As in our complaint, when a decision is taken, the software itself allows that if the decision is not implemented or executed, the person can then click the non-execution tab. And then automatically we take it up again for hearing to see how do we do it later, what do we do about it for execution. Even in conciliation, we have now introduced that. So in conciliation, something is agreed upon and not adhered to, maybe not for delinquency reasons, but then for whatever reason, the person needs to again go back to the same conciliator. So we are doing that. So we learn further from that as to why, how do we ensure that anything agreed upon gets adhered to 100%. Yep.
Are there any timelines for conciliation and adjudication?
The Act says that for all quasi-judicial complaints that are filed, you should try and dispose them of in 60 days. Initially, we were able to do that. Later on, we found that whenever you have advocates, then they will ask for tariq pe tariq. The first day he will come and say, my senior is busy in the High Court. No, you dare not say, no, I will hear the matter. Though I am nasty enough to say that this is not a court, this is a quasi-judicial forum. Therefore, whatever is your preparation, you please come and say. But many times it's not possible. So, of late we have seen that that 60-day has got breached. In conciliation, as I was answering to you, in many cases it has happened on the first day, or first sitting itself. In many cases it has actually gone on longer because it required further discussion. But we have prevented advocates to advocate there in the conciliation forum. We expect the people themselves to raise their points, discuss and resolve it. Yeah.
So is the nature of complaint shapes if people are going to conciliation or complaint? Does the nature of complaint or the nature of the issue shapes that?
Essentially, either in conciliation or us, in our case, 90% of the complaints are of this nature, that the project, and 90% of the complaints, if not 90, even more maybe, are pertaining to the legacy projects, where there were problems, along with the problems, we brought them under the ambit of the Act. So once that has come in, project is already delayed, and there are further these problems of the project further getting delayed, the person is uncertain, should I remain in the project? We keep on saying the RERA Act is meant for giving you a home. RERA Act is not a forum where you should just go there to encash and put in your ATM card and say, please give me my money, I want to go out. If you treat RERA as a consumer court, that no, enough of this, give me my money, then I think you are misreading RERA. Because RERA Act, as I mentioned, was meant for completion. RERA Act allowed it extra time to complete. RERA Act talked about a RERA fund and ring-fencing it for completion. Therefore, we keep on telling allottees that even if suppose the chips are down and the developer finally puts his hand up and says, no, I can't do it, the Act is such a robust Act, it says under Section 7, revoke his registration and give the powers to all the decision-making powers to this association of allottees, which is more than 50% of the allottees, and they shall then do everything that is necessary to complete the balance work, and the authority shall assist them in doing so. Very recently, we have a landmark judgment of a developer, one of the biggest developers at one point of time in Maharashtra, D.S. Kulkarni, sitting in jail. And we had one of his projects, which in fact was going nowhere. Good point was that the project was 80% complete. 60% of the flats were sold and individual buyers. Remaining 40% were all mortgaged to Tata Capital. So all the projects were 40% encumbrance of Tata, the financial institution, other 60% buyers. Buyers did not know where to go. It started off again, as it happens. Individual cases coming, because those people are not together. They are not thinking as to what will happen. And there is one section 18 of the Act which says that if you want to be in the project, this is a new section was brought in for the first time in this Act. If you want to be in the project, you can remain in the project, and for the delay, you will continue to get delayed interest. So you become a creditor who also earns interest out of the money that you have put in, and also you'll get the home completed. Now, somehow, I find it a little contradictory. Both cannot go together. Either the money that you have put into the RERA account should go into completing the project, or the money should be actually put under liquidation and take out all the money, and with the haircut, you give the money back. This is how it can happen. So therefore, in few projects, in few of these, this project, Sadapuli, DSK, you can actually go and find out the Sadapuli order, DSK Sadapuli. The people got the order. So who is going to pay you the money? You have the order in your hand. The advocate has walked away with his fees. And he's very happy saying that, now, aapko to order dila diya maine. But who's going to give you the money? The chap is sitting in jail. So when the thrice it happened, thereafter these people came and said, sir, mera execution nahi ho raha hai. Main kaha tum to pagal ho. You are talking about, I want to get out of the project, give me my money. Who is going to give you money? I am sitting here to empower you to see how the project will get completed. So kaise hoga? I think you have to form an association. So we made them form an association. The association got registered. The association filed a complaint under Section 7. We called Tata Capital. We used the good offices of Hiranandani and Company, who got Rajiv Sabharwal, the CEO of Tata Capital. He also attended that hearing. And he said, yes, I could have gone under Surface Act. I was thinking of going to the NCLT under the IBC. But then what you are explaining, I think this makes sense. If we put in a little bit of money, and with this amount of juice left in the project, I get 40% of the flats completed, and they will come to me. Other 60% also feel that I'll get the home. And then this question came up that 20% remaining money has to come from you. And all of them agreed. And this is what is noted down in my order. And now we have put a resolution professional in the form of Mr. Hiranandani and the Sirish Deshpande, who work like insolvency professionals in the resolution plan. But there the resolution plan equally leads you to liquidation. Here I say my resolution plan leads you to completion. So this resolution panel of two will sit with them and in 4 months work out a financial blueprint as to how the project will get completed. And I am 100% sure that this project will get completed. So this, I think, is the way we have to look at the implementation of RERA Act. And that's how we are taking it forward. So SRO was this concept where we found that majority of these standalone developers need to owe allegiance to some group. So we created this SRO. It's something in the making, but I'm 100% sure that this is also going to yield results for us. We have talked to this, we are trying to create this MahaRERA chapter of IRP. We spoke to IBBI that you have this set of insolvency professionals, as I just now mentioned, who are doing resolution plan, but the resolution plan is usually throwing out the earlier developer, bringing in a new developer who gets in with a haircut. So that's how you work there. Here my thing is that no, you don't throw out the earlier developer to bring in a new developer. You certainly throw out or keep aside the earlier developer, but here you bring in the buyers and the financial institution who has stakes in the project in the form of mortgage to come together and take the process forward. You assist them in preparing that blueprint to take it forward. So we have had first round of discussion. They are now talking to Sahu of IBBI, and we will very soon have this list, because this number of such projects which are becoming not insolvent, which are becoming stressed and getting stalled is now rising. Now, we will not have many such professionals available with us from the conciliation forum who will be doing to do this hand-holding to take the process forward. So that's how it is. Yeah. And I think that's the last slide. Next. So, challenges, yes, please.
Yeah, just on the IBC, just on the IBC point, I think we saw this process sort of happening with the JP Group projects and the projects in UP as well. There is a big court's intervention and creating home buyers as a class of creditors who can also be included within that process. What have the learnings from this thing been? Especially since you said the focus is on completion,
yeah,
as opposed to the IBC thing, which is on
getting go back home with the haircut.
Yeah, get people's money back. Mm. So since your focus is the other end.
No, I have been always saying this, and with at the top of my voice, I have been telling the ministry that the simple thing should be that this is an act which is for this sector. This is a sector-specific act. The IBC is talking about all sectors. So if you have a specific act meant for the sector, that should take precedence over the other one, number one.
Yes.
Now, there is a problem of sort of jurisdiction. NCLT feels that no, we are manned by High Court judges. So we understand and we will do correct justice to these people. These are a bunch of bureaucrats who have come in and they are running this. So therefore, NCLT is at a different pedestal. RERA is somewhere here. Accept it. I don't want to get into that. So what I have suggested, I was telling Deepak today, without tampering with or making any amendments in the Act, a simple thing can be that if a project where a person raises a complaint to the NCLT under IBC happens to be a RERA registered project, instead of just admitting on the face value and applying a moratorium on that group company and everything stops till the IRP sits and decides that, can the NCLT give a reasonable time to the concerned RERA authority to see whether the RERA authority has already started this job of trying to see whether there is a resolution plan in the form of completion of the project or not? I feel that is something which is not asking for the moon. It's a very reasonable demand. And I hope someday it will get accepted. So that's how it is. Problems are, as I mentioned, major problem that we have faced, majority of the complaints are all coming in these legacy projects, old projects, delayed, and there are problems like that in UP, in Haryana, in Maharashtra, everywhere. We are going through this pain of transition. If you have an act which brings in the legacy projects and the hangover of the past, then the period of transition becomes a little longer. And we have added problems of the ILFS and NBFC crisis, it becomes further longer. So I initially thought my pain of transition would be 3 years. It seems it will go further longer, for 5 years. So then only maybe we will move into an era where, yes, it's a regulated sector and everything is moving fine. This, once we started saying that everything will be on the digital platform, how do you create that awareness and professionalism among the players? SRO is going to help us doing that, I feel. So we have seen, especially in tier 2, 3 cities, this is a major problem. Lack of general awareness, not only among this stakeholder, the developers, even for the home buyers. Still, in fact, the other day I was in my bank. I was talking to the person. He said, sir, I'm kharid raha hu. Sir, aap to RERA mein hai. I said, yes, have you gone to the website? Nahi, sir, ye to nahi kiya maine. Jo aap kharid raha hu, is it a RERA registered project? Nahi, sir, ye to maine nahi dekha. So, a banker. And he still doesn't know that now if you are making this decision to buy a home, the first thing you should know, is it RERA registered? And that merely doesn't satisfy. Then you go into that web page, check for yourself all the details, and make that decision, an informed decision. Still not happening. Way ahead. Further, if we can bring in more transparency, we need to do that. How we can do that, that's another thing. Accountability, as I mentioned, can the other professionals attached to the project, the engineers, architects, can we have further handholding sessions, uniformity, standardization, and bring in more professionalism in their approach. Timely completion remains. This is the major objective of the Act. And stress projects every day increasing. How do you tackle stress projects? You cannot have always this DSK thing, and it may not succeed every time, because a case-to-case approach will have to be followed. So every time it will succeed or not, I do not know. But that would be the single most challenge, the biggest challenge, as to how do we ensure that if I have 23,500 registered projects, at some point of time, every project, not a single project, will go under liquidation. It must get completed. So that, according to me, is the biggest challenge. How do you rebuild the trust? Again, I feel that we need to work towards that, and then only this sector will become robust. We cannot only thrive on this. Oh, developer, barabar maar se. Oh, bacha acha kya usko thoka. Now, this is what the media is very happy. Many of my colleagues feel, oh, that an order. Oh, mera order bada bada likha hai. Oh, isne jo hai isko 50 lakh ka de. But then, that is hardly doing anything to rebuild trust. How do we rebuild trust? I think that's we. How do we further improve the quality of the work? How do we bring in more skill among the workmen there? And professionalizing among the agents through SRO and many other things. If this succeeds, then we take it to the agents also. Thank you.